Hi everybody, Matt Lawton here. This is the Astrological Winds channel. I'm going to take a look at the astrological weather forecast for the week of May 24th through the 30th. And this is going to be the beginning of a time of like basically about a month, most of June, but really starting right now when there's going to be some significant changes that we should see coming our way in our lives, in society. You know, the Saturn Uranus square, as I've said over and over, is the biggest aspect of this year that's influencing this year, and we watch it slowly changing structures all on all kinds of levels, physical and above physical, in society, in our personal lives. So, you know, the Saturn-Uranus square has three exact hits, and in the middle of June, we're going to hit what we call the second or retrograde hit, where many times we feel like we're in the middle or the deepest part of the issues where they can feel really, really stuck. And so we have a bunch of other stuff going on that is setting up a lot of that energy. And that even started last week a little bit on Sunday or yesterday. And I talked about last week that Saturn went retrograde. So that's why we're going to get that retrograde hit. The slower of the two planets, Saturn in this case, will be going back and hitting Uranus at a second exact time. So that is the first step in moving towards this more difficult time. And this week is kind of interesting. There's like two really main things to talk about. A couple other smaller things, but and they're both related to, once again, setting up a time where we're going to see a lot of change and transition. And so, you know, just also, besides Saturn going retrograde on Sunday, this is the week that Mercury is going to go retrograde, which is part of one of the things we're going to talk about this week. So that is also part of the makeup of bringing us back. We all know how Mercury retrograde acts, and you know that's going to be part of this next month also, is this, you know, Mercury retrograde and, you know, having to deal with that energy too. But this week triggers even is another event which I mentioned last week too. It is eclipse season number one for 2021. We'll have eclipses in June and December this year. The nodal axis still in North Node in Gemini and the South Node in Sagittarius, which, as I've said over and over in the past year, a need to break free of old belief systems that are holding us back and making connections on local levels with people, sharing information, and really focusing on those levels and what's right for us and what's true for us, and in finding the right people with the right connections, with the right information for us. So this is what's going on now. We got the sun, remember, going into Gemini, so getting really close to that north node. And we're going to have a full moon at 6 degrees Sagittarius, and that will be on Wednesday, and that is also a lunar eclipse. So when we have a full moon, we have a lunar eclipse, and because the sun is so close to that north node in Gemini, and the moon, of course, is close to the south node in Sagittarius during a full moon lunar eclipse. So first of all, we know, like, you know, the full moon always, you know, shines the light on a lot of things that are going on. in our subconscious and start to come up and to be seen fully, and not only us, but other people around us too. So there's always that. And we know that, you know, people act out on that. So like that full moon in Sag wants to actually take in more. It wants, like, you know, this sense of adventure, of wanting to really expand horizons, to meet and go to new places, new people, bring in new knowledge, get new insight. And what's interesting about this full moon and lunar eclipse is it is in a T-square with the ruler of the full moon. Full moon's in Sagittarius, which makes Jupiter the ruler of the full moon, and it is in a T-square configuration with Jupiter, which, if you'll remember, just a couple weeks back, went into its own sign of Pisces rulership. So really, like, Sagittarius and Pisces and the moon and Jupiter all really kind of congealing together on, like, wanting to expand horizons in the sense of, like, having a more, like, open mind, allowing ourselves to be open to new information that's coming from different sources that are beyond our normal or ordinary sources. So look, you know, for those new people or places or things or situations that are bringing in new information to you right now and somehow expanding your life, because those people are going to actually broaden your experiences, bring a lot of excitement and adventure into your life, and help you to, like, widen your own value system and philosophy of life, your spiritual journey, maybe even, like, your artistic inspiration or just inspiration for other things too. So there's, like, a real nice mix, despite the T-square, of this energy of wanting to expand and broaden things, and it can, you know, be both abstract and physical or concrete. Now, what's interesting about it, like, it's a lunar eclipse, and eclipses many times represent a big change in our life. It's like, as I said this before about eclipses, it's like walking down a street in one direction for a long, long time, and then all of a sudden you make a right or a left turn and you completely head off in another direction. And that's what eclipses can do to our life if they hit us directly. Now, this full moon eclipse is at 6 degrees Sagittarius, so, like, any planets that you have around 5, 6, 7 degrees could get hit by this full moon, or the sun also in that same position in Gemini, and be dragged into this. But it's also going to be at a certain axis in your chart. Like, the moon will be in one house and the sun will be in the opposite house. So whatever axis that is those are the two houses representing an axis in your life that where this full moon will really play out. Now, the thing is about the lunar eclipse, it's different than a solar eclipse. Many times a lunar eclipse does not necessarily bring acute physical events to us. It actually many times springs more from within. Like, where is our emotions at? So in this case, with the moon in Sag, you know, the emotions are really wanting more. They want to, you know, broaden those horizons stuff. So, like, what that does is when you have that kind of energy, you're actually creating that yourself. Now, what's interesting when you think about both the sun and moon squaring Jupiter in Pisces, so it's nice in Pisces. It loves to be in Pisces. Jupiter can get, you know, very, very, you know, spiritual, creative, artistic in Pisces. So, like, so it can really, you know, be a nice thing there. But the square shows that sometimes, despite having, like, these grandiose visions and plans for the future that are starting to come from within, and maybe you're seeing events outside that are starting to tie into that, that we may be, like, taking on more than we actually can handle right now, or that we have in physical reality to actually make happen. And especially with Saturn just going retrograde and Mercury about to go retrograde, it's kind of like, well, yeah, there we have these great ideas, maybe even like these new things coming in, but maybe we don't have the resources or the time or the money or whatever of enough yet to make it really happen in reality yet. So I think that's where the tension of that T-square is going to come out. But the thing is, remember, those squares are going to spur us to act and want to, you know, pursue those things. So there's like a lot there that's saying, hey, you know, these possibilities are out there for us, especially with the Sag and the Jupiter. It's all like kind of acting for the future stuff. So it's like, you know, it's out there, but like there's other stuff that needs to be like taken care of, possibly like in our, you know, physical life or just in the things we have going on within, where that, you know, lunar eclipse energy. But, you know, the full moon can really help us see where that stuff is. So, you know, and obviously, too, like, you know, the Jupiter and the Pisces and all that really, you know, comes on this very exuberant, optimistic, compassionate, generous side. But the negative side of that is to go into a place of, like, arrogance and self-righteousness and preachiness even about, you know, what we feel that, you know, is right and what we believe in. So it's interesting, but like I said, Jupiter being the ruler of that whole chart too, or that full moon, you know, Jupiter brings a lot of benefits. So like if we can, you know, align those value systems with what we see going on around us and with the people around us and those things, then we have a really good chance in the future once we can get all the resources lined up, all the things we need to deal with in reality set up, that we can actually have a really big push forward of personal growth, advancement, expanded consciousness, expanded philosophical value system, more tolerance, all those types of things. So very, very interesting energy in this full moon. So look, you know, like I said, look in your chart where the, you know, 6 degrees of Sag and Gemini fall, and that's the axis that it will be, you know, parts of your life that it will be most influencing. And then any planet in those degree zones that are being hit will definitely, like, especially for you folks who have mutable planets in those zones, it is a mutable T-square. So I was saying, you know, we're going to have to adjust a lot on the fly. We're going to have to remain flexible to changing circumstances in order to meet a lot of those goals. So that's like really a big kickoff to you a very, very intense next few weeks of energy, just like that Saturn retrograde kind of pulling in. And then just quickly, on Thursday, Venus is square Neptune, and so that can get us, like, you know, putting like rose-colored glasses on about mainly relationships, really, and kind of like setting ourselves up maybe to be a little bit disappointed by not being realistic about relationships, and therefore people around us, our loved ones, not being able to live up to our idealistic vision of what we see in a relationship. So many times what's really a nice way to express that energy is through art, because there's like, you know, a little bit of that tension. So like, okay, I can't have that in reality, but let me create something that expresses that ideal, like, and many times, like, you know, acting kind of art, like, you know, literally just like acting out that kind of thing. But there's a lot of like inspiration and imagination that can be downloaded off of this still. We just have to realize that we can easily get lost in, like, you know, kind of like almost like an immature way of looking at like how things could possibly be, especially within relationships. So the other big thing I really want to talk about this week is the Mercury retrograde, which is actually going to be conjunct Venus, and also both of them quincunx Pluto. And that's going to be like all next weekend. So it's an interesting mix of energy. I mean, first off, you know, when Mercury and Venus get together, normally it's like really an ability to express our emotions well, to articulate our emotions to others very well, to like be, and it's like it can be a little intellectually driven, but it has a good understanding of emotions, and also like, once again, like artistic output with words, like the love of language and words. So like, you know, like lyrical poetry, music, anything like, you know, story writing, things like that, or any kind of like artistic or creative energy having to do with words is something that Mercury and Venus, when they get together, is very prevalent. But also, when you think about it too, in Gemini, that just like once again kind of pushes it towards the mental or intellectual side of things, like wanting to talk about a lot of the things you've discovered recently in your own experiences and world. But here we have Mercury actually stationing retrograde, and will be retrograde, I believe, until the 20th. But staying in Gemini is the sign that it rules. So that's very interesting, because it seems to me what may really happen during this period of Mercury retrograde is an overstimulation of the mind with like so much information coming in that it's really hard to get a handle on it all. And it can like lead us down paths that are kind of like pointless or don't really go anywhere, so to speak. But they're also, you know, can be, it's interesting when you bring in the quincunx to Pluto too, because what that's saying is we're seeing a lot of deep stuff ourselves, like maybe within ourselves, within other people, within the world, those kind of things. And we're like really chewing a lot of that stuff over. But it's interesting because, you know, Pluto kind of makes us want to like almost like force our point of view upon others. And when we've got it going with the quincunx and retrograde Mercury, you start to think like people are kind of like maybe holding a lot of what they're really doing or why. The why of what they're doing within is a good way to say it. Like, they're not going to be openly expressing the reasoning behind what they're doing during this Mercury retro period. And so it'll feel a little bit secretive, coercive, and like, you know, as if people are acting out from a spot within themselves that's trying to align others or situations into what they want without exposing themselves. So it's very, very interesting on that level, and it can create a lot of what would be the misunderstandings within that Mercury retrograde framework where communication breaks down because people are holding stuff or not being truthful or using their words mainly to push a subjective thing, then it can create a lot of misunderstandings and it can create a lot of communication breakdowns and the misuse of information and things like that. So that could be where we see that. But, you know, when you think about Mercury in Gemini too, I would also expect during this retrograde period a lot of, like, issues with local movement. Like, I'm just taking longer to get around for whatever reason, construction or whatever. You know, I don't know, whatever it could be. You know, it could be, like, things that kind of slow down local movement. But, like, really trying to discern, once again, all this information we're getting. That's what that Mercury-Pluto is saying again, too. Like, really taking it within and trying to discern what's really good, what's really not so good. So there's that. And then, and so, like, we're going to be in this Mercury retrograde period for 3 weeks, and really, you know, the shadow will go through all of June. So we're going to have, like, a lot of, you know, this is once again setting up a lot of, like, intense energy for the next few weeks, and just having to, like, really look at a lot of this energy. Now, this week, the day that the Saturn-Uranus square gets triggered by the moon is actually today, Monday. It opposes the moon in Scorpio, opposes Uranus, and squares Saturn. So there's a T-square, fixed T-square there, where, you know, you may feel like you have to make some sudden decisions because of, like, some upsetting news, most likely brought in one-on-one situations, and it feel like, you know, that you need to kind of break free from. So it's going to be, like, you know, a week of, like, you know, really, you know, wanting and to, you know, push a lot of those new things that you see with that full moon coming from within, the lunar eclipse, expansion with the Jupiter, but realizing there's a lot of things that need to be taken care of first, the Saturn retrograde, and then we can fall into this period of just, like, an overstimulation of information and stuff that kind of really clogs and slows down the normal intellectual processes with Mercury in retrograde in Gemini and an air sign. So it's the beginning of several weeks of intense change. And next week, we will not only have the weekly, but I'll also look at the monthly for June. And, you know, just, you know, exciting news, you know, just like, you know, once again, this is a free service, the astrological weather report for the week, and I'm getting a lot of good response. More and more followers on YouTube, started looking at my podcast stats and was very excited to see that there's people watching in Europe, there's people watching in China, welcome, thank you. All I can say to all you folks that are watching out there is to, you know, to pay me back, please find someone else to pass the blog on to. It's a free service. I am available for all kinds of readings, though, and discuss prices with me. You can email me at matthue823@gmail.com. And And I'm, you know, natal readings, there's predictive readings to look at your next year, elections for when the best timing of an event, query questions if you really have a question that's burning that you can't get a good decision on, children's charts, relationship charts, fixed star readings for deeper soul meaning, purpose, astrocartography, locational, if you're looking to move somewhere or finding a place where you want to get certain planets within power, and a lot of exciting stuff in the sense of like seeing the blog, you know, getting bigger, and so I'm you know thinking that may start going up to some next levels, try to get my website republished with some really new things on it that'll be interesting for people. And, you know, maybe start some other new social media outlets for getting into deeper levels of stuff into soon. And also, there are classes available. I have 5 beginners classes available at any time for anyone right now. They are Dropbox files, $25 a class, unless you're a student with a student ID, but 20 a class. I will continue doing more classes soon too. I have a few students, but no one's really pushing me to get more classes done. But there are the, you know, the 12 signs of the zodiac. So if you want to just do a one-off class, they're available too. Some people like to give a donation. My email, that address I gave before, matthue823@gmail.com, is also my Zelle account, so you're welcome to give any kind of donation there, $1 to whatever you want to give. And like I said, but even more importantly, just get the blog out to people. So thank you for everybody who's been tuning in. Thank you for people in other places besides North America and beyond. My expansion, lots of people in Canada noticed too. So so it's been great, great responses, very happy, and we'll continue the service. And now I think we're gonna maybe get into some deeper layers of my services that I'll try to start making available on other social media platforms and website stuff. So keep in tune for that. Okay, until next week, this is Matt Lawton. This is the Astrological Winds Channel. Become a follower on YouTube, available on all kinds of podcasts. I saw the podcast list the other day, and there's like literally like 15 of them. So just look it up, at least 15 of them. Look it up. I know Apple iPodcast is definitely the leader in people watching it, but it's available on all other ones too. All right, until next week, have a good week, and I will see you soon.